As China grew richer and stronger, we believed that the Chinese Communist Party would liberalize and meet the rising democratic aspirations of its people. Now, this was a bold and quintessentially American idea. It was born of our innate optimism and by the experience of our triumph over Soviet communism. Unfortunately, it turned out to be very naive. We could not have been more wrong. And this miscalculation was the greatest failure of American foreign policy since the 1930s. I appreciate the kind invitation to come discuss an issue of critical importance to American national security with you, Governor, and with your colleagues here in Arizona. The challenge of the Chinese Communist Party and the rise of the Chinese Communist Party and the threat that it poses to the United States and our allies is of critical importance to us right now. America, under President Trump's leadership, has finally awoken to the threat of the Chinese Communist Party's actions and the threat that they pose to our very way of life. Now, for decades, the conventional wisdom in both U.S. political parties, the business community, academia, the media, has held that it was only a matter of time before China would become more liberal, first economically, and then politically. The more we opened our markets to China, the thinking went. The more we invested capital in China, the more we trained PRC, bureaucrats, scientists, engineers, and even military officers, the more China would become like us. It was under this premise that we welcomed China into the World Trade Organization in 2001 with vast concessions and trade privileges. We downplayed China's gross human rights abuses, including Tiananmen Square. We turned a blind eye to China's widespread technology theft that eviscerated entire sectors of the American economy. As China grew richer and stronger, we believed that the Chinese Communist Party would liberalize and meet the rising democratic aspirations of its people. Now, this was a bold and quintessentially American idea. It was born of our innate optimism and by the experience of our triumph over Soviet communism. Unfortunately, it turned out to be very naive. We could not have been more wrong. And this miscalculation was the greatest failure of American foreign policy since the 1930s. Now, how did we make such a mistake? How did we fail to understand the nature of the Chinese Communist Party? And the answer is simple. It's because we did not pay heed to the CCP's ideology. Instead of listening to what CCP leaders were saying, instead of reading what they wrote in their key documents, we closed our eyes and our ears. We believed what we wanted to believe, that these party members were communist in name only. Now, let's be clear, the Chinese Communist Party is a Marxist-Leninist organization. The party General Secretary Xi Jinping sees himself as Joseph Stalin's successor. In fact, as the journalist and former Australia government official John Garneau has noted, the Chinese Communist Party is the last ruling Communist Party that never split with Stalin, with the partial exception of North Korea. Yes, Stalin, the man whose brutal dictatorship and disastrous policies killed roughly 20 million Russians and others through famine, forced collectivization, execution, and labor camps. As interpreted by Lenin, Stalin, Mao, communism is a totalitarian ideology. Under communism, individuals are merely a means to be used towards the achievement of the ends of the collective nation state. Thus, individuals can be easily sacrificed for the nation state's goals. Individuals do not have inherent value under Marxism-Leninism. They exist to serve the state. The state does not exist to serve them. Now, these ideas sound remote and outdated to us as we speak them. They are, after all, old ideas. They were born a century and a half ago in Europe. They were implemented a century ago in Russia. And then they were discarded 30 years ago as the most costly failed political experiment in history. But in China, these ideas remain as fundamental to the Chinese Communist Party as the Constitution and the Bill of Rights do to us as Americans. The Chinese Communist Party seeks total control over the people's lives. This means economic control. It means political control. It means physical control. And perhaps most importantly, it means thought control. In classical Chinese statecraft, Garneau has noted, there are two tools for gaining and maintaining control over the mountains and the rivers. The first is wu, weapons and violence. And the second is wen, language and culture, Chinese leaders have always believed that power derives from controlling both the physical battlefield and the cultural domain. For Lenin, Stalin, Mao, and now Xi, Garneau writes, words are not vehicles of reason and persuasion. They are bullets. Words are for defining, isolating, and destroying opponents. Propaganda plays a central role for the CCP. Beijing's efforts to dominate political thought are stated openly and pursued aggressively.
大纪元时报遍布全球，不受财团、政党影响，真实感言。不管是想了解国际局势、两岸议题，或者想要寓教于乐、丰富人生，您需要的都在大纪元时报。订报专线0800566688。